Hi, my name is Nate Richardson, and I'm going to share with you a topic called the God of Individualized Contracts. Similar to my article, Life is a Pickle, you could say that's the prequel to this topic. God of Individualized Contracts, the idea that people can be different and that is pleasing to God. That's the other side of the coin, of course, is the emulation of Christ, which is universal, our universal standard. Long have people made deals with God, promising actions for rewards. God has many generalized contracts with man, wherein we obey foreordained laws and receive predetermined rewards based on laws irrevocably set before the foundation of the world. In fact, President Hinckley said at one one time that a couple should live paying their tithing so that when they needed a blessing from God, they could essentially kneel down and tell God, "Look, I've kept this commandment and I need this blessing." He used some sort of phraseology like, "I have earned this blessing." Okay? That's a very special thing that God, it's like when you get your kid to do chores, there's a reward. Okay? There's also a doctrine of God looking upon our individual circumstances and taking into account how that modifies our ability, how that modifies, let's see, looking at our individual circumstances and taking into account how our individual circumstances modify our ability to execute and understand God and His plan. God will always load all the mercy He can into our contract. Into your contract, into my contract. But we must always seek individual accountability rather than blaming our circumstances for our attitudes and behaviors. I believe it was President Kimball who said outright, if you're blaming your parents on your circumstance, however much they did have to do with it, then that's the way of the escapist. Okay? What's right for one person may to do may be wrong for another. We are judged not only by what we did, but why we did it. We think of an Ender's Game when he, his, when they're screening him for a special mission, they said, "Well, it's not necessarily what you did; it's why you did it." And it's a lot to think about right there. We do what the Holy Ghost tells us. That is the great law of God, the daily revelation which orients us. This means that from person to person, a God-fearing life can look quite different. It's like when Nephi, someone can, critics of the Book of Mormon have said, well, God wouldn't have someone chop off someone else's head to get a book, which was what Nephi did. He chopped off Laban's head. The Holy Ghost said, take him out, and you need this record. And some have argued that it was a political move, which would make it a little bit of a different scenario or whatever. But the fact of the matter is, it boils down to is you do what God tells you. And they can say, well, God doesn't operate like that. Well, look in the Old Testament, when sometimes it says, thou shalt not kill, other times it says, thou shalt utterly destroy. Okay? Moving on here. Okay, some people are called to live among the masses, to relate to them, and to adopt many of the aspects of their culture, all within the bounds the Lord has set, of course. Some can see it as a waste of time to get involved in those things that are common and jovial and sociable, but that is an aspect of missionary work, and others may be called to a different path, a more plain road of some sort, perhaps a scholarship of some sort. But what we're getting at is that God is a God of individualized contracts. There can be a scenario for this person, a different scenario for that person, etc., and it's largely based on our desires. And of course, when we pray, we can figure out what to do. And we don't figure it out exactly. Brother Bednar talked about this question when people ask, is it the Holy Ghost or is it me? And he answered, he said, stop worrying about it. He said, he gave the story where he was on a mission and escorting then Elder Boyd K. Packer, who was an apostle, and Elder Bednar felt like giving him $20 or something, and it turned out President Packer was on the train, and the person coming around getting the tickets, he didn't have a ticket or something, and he was able to use that money to be able to get his passage home, when they didn't expect that would be the case. And so what you could ask was, was it the Holy Ghost telling Elder Bednar to give Elder Packer the $20? Well, Elder Bednar said this: "Don't worry about what that is, whether it's the Holy Ghost or you. Just be a good boy, be a good girl. Okay, try to do your best. Be nice, and if you have a good idea of doing something, try to do it." You know, President Brigham Young was known to say, "Crying babies in sacrament meeting are like good intentions. They need to be carried out." Okay. So, since the body of Christ has different members, it is of definition that not all members' lives will look the same. Some will be compelled by the Holy Ghost to pursue academics, others to pursue business, others building, etc. And there is a strong emphasis on education in the church. President Monson would say that the amount of education you get will determine your amount of influence you can have or of good for good on the world. And there are also voices that suggest trade school is another good way, or any wholesome contribution, anything that you can get good at and contribute. But what we're getting at here is that there are differences and there's different paths, and not one path is the 100%. Now, there's one path to salvation, that's Jesus Christ. But during our moral lives, there's a lot of choices that we can make and that aren't directly related to our salvation. And I believe there's missionary work to do in any of those paths. Anywhere you live, anywhere you go to school, there's going to be a bucket load of missionary work and so forth to do there. So don't worry about, "Oh, I want to go somewhere I can be a missionary." Anywhere, okay? Anywhere. Utah, other places. Doesn't matter. Some will be told by the Holy Ghost to make their careers mighty. Others will be told to spare time on it, to focus spare time on it, while others, their vocation will be but a minor component of their life's calling, and the Holy Ghost will guide them in other work that they must focus on. And Jordan Peterson suggests that the careers, most only 3% of people have careers, and most other people have jobs. And they find most meaning and usefulness in their life when they're not at work. Okay? Of course, the couch potato after work can't justify that very well. Of course, you can have recreation, have fun, and build relationships with your family doing fun things with them, but there are certainly wise parameters on how we should be using our short time. Some will be told by the Holy Ghost to make their. Okay, let's see. There. Let's see. A society has need for many different types of people who find joy in different roles. I grew up not learning a thing about mechanics. I don't really find joy in mechanics. I might if I got into it more. The Holy Ghost will lead us all to the character of Christ, but it won't lead us to the exact same circumstances and interests as others. Hugh Nibley makes this point that Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, do you think they spent all their time together and did all the same things? No, they diversified. They went and they had these certain things they liked to do, and they weren't always 24/7 by each other's side. Okay. Joseph Smith taught that to be saved, we must do it in the same way that Christ did, namely by obedience to God's laws. Thankfully, part of our contract includes repentance. Prophets have taught us that for us, repentance isn't the backup plan, it is the plan. Repenting is the best we can do. Doing our best is what is required of us, and repenting means we are doing our best. President Hinckley said, "Make it your very best." We have tons and tons of repenting to do, and when we're done repenting, as the days go along, we must repent even more. It might come as a surprise to the born-again Christian. The character that feels really great about changes he's made and commitments he's made and things he's doing well. Yeah, especially when he enters the gauntlets of marriage and parenthood. We must repent even more. Hugh Nibley was known to teach that the culture and society of God in heaven is millions of miles different from how ours is here. And so it is. We also can't perform at the same level that Christ did and must repent of the silly circumstances we get ourselves into. And I would also suggest, as I've said before, that we don't have the luxury of waiting to a ripe old age to fine-tune our character. I think they very strongly believe that the second coming of Jesus Christ is at the doors, which means that we don't have the luxury of waiting till, 20. I've got 40 years, of kind of getting out sidetracked on other things. We need to make living the gospel the center of our lives and let other stuff fall to the side where it needs to. My best may look different from your best. Certainly, Christ's best looks different from our best. In premortality, we attained different levels of obedience, knowledge, and ability, but we all crossed the threshold of qualifying for earth life. Now we are here. We again do our best to cross the threshold for admission to the celestial kingdom after this life. But not only do we seek to do enough, we seek to give our all. To get to earth, the bar wasn't really that high. Look at, you've got your Hitlers, etc. They at some point had elected in premortality to follow God's plan and come to earth, rejecting Lucifer and his one third that didn't come to earth and didn't get their bodies. Okay, so premortality, the bar wasn't that high, I would suggest. Here we are on earth. This is like phase two. This is like graduate school, or it's like coming out of elementary school into high school. It's whatever it is, it's the next step, okay? And it's a different scenario. It's not just you get a letter grade, A, B, C, D, E, or A, B, C, D, F. Perhaps everyone who scored an F in premortality is with Lucifer and the Sons of Perdition. But you could score a D, you're in. Hitler probably scored a D. D minus. But here it's different. It's not so much the letter grades. It's not only a test, but this life is an apprenticeship. And it's about how are we emulating the master? Are our desires on emulation of the master? Are our desires on the right things? I don't like to discourage doing the written laws. It's important to do the written laws, like going to church on Sunday, okay? You don't go and you can't, but when you can, you do. And you spiritually prepare yourself to be able to stay spiritually afloat if there came a time when church wasn't available. But to qualify for the highest glory of God in the life to come, there are different rules to the game. It's not just the A through F kind of scenario, okay? It's no longer about thresholds and lines. It's about free will offerings to God. It's about giving yourself to serve God more so than meeting minimum requirements. It's about whether you will put on the character and lifestyle of God or settle for something else. We don't really talk about the terrestrial, the middle kingdom of glory, because no one shoots for the middle. We all shoot for the highest. In reality, we can all make it to the highest. The doctrine that there's a set limit of the number of people who can dwell with God in eternity, as is seen in the Jehovah's Witness faith, is such a sad doctrine to think that there's a limit. We all shoot for the highest. In reality, we can all make it to the highest if we set our priorities straight. Gospel instructions today are more clear than ever, and once we leave the grasps of the devil through repentance, we find that the yoke of Christ is easy and his burden is light. That is what he said. Well known is the doctrine of the parable of the laborers in the vineyard, wherein the early laborers get paid a penny in the same wage as the late, which is the same wage as the late laborers. The penny represents the gift of eternal life, which is becoming as God. The early laborers could think that they need more pay since they've been working longer, but you can't get more pay than that. That's the max. You can't become better than God. They may think that it's not fair that the late laborers get similarly paid as the early, meaning those who came to activity in the gospel get eternal life, not just the lifelong faithful members. But they must realize that their early employment in the vineyard has prepared them to receive the penny, whereas the latecomers will have some more things to sort out before they can make good use of it. Further, we must recognize that in and out of the church, we are all going through hard things in life. This is something important that's been impressed on me, that is that in or out of the church, we're all learning good things and making good progress. This life is a growing experience for everyone, and in fact, even the mentally disabled, severely mentally disabled, they can all progress. There should And actually, that thing about the even the mentally disabled making progress in the earth life, that was something that a 70 came. My mom was in the serving as a missionary in the seminary, helping the disabled kids, especially in kids. And that was the message that the 70 brought with them, was that even the severely disabled make progress in this life. They learn what it's like to have a body, even a broken one. We should all have a great appreciation for this life and a great respect for everyone on this earth, regardless of what they're doing, religious, non-religious, moral, immoral. Everyone here deserves to be here, and everyone here has a fighting chance of winning. And it's very special. One of the things that I had one of my favorite teachers, Donald Perry, in the Hebrew department at BYU, back when he was still also in the religion department, he taught us that just be very careful not to judge others. Even a look at the famous Marilyn Monroe. You don't know what's she became the biggest sex symbol of her time, but look at her childhood. She had an extremely abusive mother who would put her in suitcases and just bundle her around, and this just terrifying stuff. And she finally found someone who would appreciate her, and that was someone who wanted to take her picture, and it went downhill from there. But these kids from abused circumstances, who they'll take any form of love, even bad love, which you could say isn't really love, but anyway, any form of acceptance, I guess. So we can all progress in this life. And I mean, look at the people who don't even hear about religion in their lives, okay, or the people who have no understanding of it. There's the whole doctrine of missionary work in the spirit world for those people. Everyone on this earth is learning and progressing, and God is with everyone. He's not just with the Latter-day Saints. He's not just with the Christians. He's with everyone. He's with the religious people of all kinds and the irreligious people of all kinds. Now, those who openly worship Satan, yeah, I don't think God's happy about that. But, and of course, various codes of conduct and our political views, too. Politics is kind of a religion in and of itself, because what you view politically is what you're willing to essentially force on everyone. You're saying if there should be a law made on this, that means everyone should be forced to do it. And your opinions on what you should force people to do, that's moral. That's a moral conversation. So that's why they say don't discuss religion and politics with people, right? It's because they both deal with morals. When you're saying someone's wrong in theirs, or that the such and such is better, yeah, it is about hierarchy of good, better, best, and bad, worse, and despicable. So politics are very, and there's a great book on that by H. Verlin Anderson, who was a 70, called The Great and Abominable Church of the Devil. He basically identifies how the doctrines of communism are of the devil, and it's forced charity. It's really not hard to see. But he was a lawyer, very good at outlining things clearly. There's a sort of an outline of that book on Richardson Studies and so forth. Very highly suggested reading there. All right, so I would suggest that life is harder outside of the church. Okay, so remember the person who gets the penny, the early laborer and the late laborer. Life is harder outside of the church. Or in other words, the people who come to the vineyard later, they're in the church now. They're getting qualifying for all the blessings. They're getting baptized. They're taking the covenant sponsor. They're learning how to be covenant keepers. But life's harder outside of the church. There's not the constant companionship of the Holy Ghost. There's the visitations of the Holy Ghost. But Joseph Smith taught that if someone has the visitations of the Holy Ghost and rejects baptism and the conferral of the Holy Ghost by the priesthood authority, you're not going to have the constant companionship of the Holy Ghost. That is a gift. It is a priesthood ordinance gift, not freely dispensed. Okay? Conscience, or the light of Christ, that is freely dispensed. Everyone who comes to this world, having chose Christ in the premortal existence, will have conscience or the light of Christ. Can that light be extinguished? Yeah. Laman and Lemuel were past feeling. So, and President Pack, gosh, President Packer, if you ever heard something good, it was probably President Packer, right? Now, somebody might have been, of course, anything from the apostles is good, but maybe it was, I don't remember who this was, Bednar, spoke to somebody that as you get further away from living the gospel, it can become like a cloudy day, and what you used to could see outside, you can't see anymore. That's a pretty interesting thing. I also have a fun little theory that a lot of the pollution today that makes it we can't see stars outside is contributing to people's lack of belief in God. You live in the big cities, you can't see the stars. Okay, and when you can't see the stars, you're less prone to think about the cosmos, less prone to think about God, maybe. Okay? In the scriptures, it says there will be great pollutions in the last days, as describing one of the bad scenarios of the last days. All right, so life is harder outside of the church, and we don't get the comforting guidance of the constant companionship of the Holy Ghost. Those who are the early laborers are well fed spiritually and enjoy spiritual satiation and have that comfort and so forth through their lives. That remember the sign of the Holy Ghost being with you, it means that you're on the right path to exaltation, to eternal life. So think of how it would be, how hard it would be to not have that comfort and guidance on a regular basis. The latecomers have to experience spiritual hunger, which is the most painful sort of hunger. Let them come and feast on the gospel of Christ and their souls be satisfied. Let the long-time laborers receive with thankfulness anyone who chooses to come and participate in not only the labor of the vineyard, but the blessings thereof. See Elder Holland's talk titled Laborers in the Vineyard, April 2012, at the General Conference. Almost finished here. Let's just have a few more thoughts. It seems common sense that the person being beat down by 10 thugs isn't expected to walk away in the same shape as the person who endures a one-on-one combat. The battles we face in this life are thus, for reasons known only to God, different for each of us. But God has designated this life as a test to try each of us. God wants us to show improvement in this life more than wanting us to overcome all things. Joseph Smith taught that salvation is in overcoming all things, but that such may not be fully attained in this life. There is much to learn yet beyond the grave. I think the Egyptian texts or somewhere speak of, Hugh Nibley talks about this, how there is something like 60 endowments to have beyond the grave. It would be make a lot of sense. And of course, the endowment, there is the, in the, on like the first page of I think it's, his name's Cohen or Conan, the book, he has a book on temples. He was this institute teacher at BYU. Anyway, he has a quote from one of the prophets there that says essentially that Heavenly Father's endowment that he received while on his earth and so forth, on the earth he grew up on and so forth, he's still drawing power from that to do what he does. Truly, the endowment that we receive in the temple is eternally powerful. No one except Christ will have lived a perfect life. Christ is the prototype of a saved being whom we seek to emulate. But thankfully, God knows our abilities and capacities, and will not require us the same that was required at the hand of Christ. Some must walk daunting paths of loneliness. Others must brave. Alright, so there's different kinds of things going on here. Some must walk the daunting path of loneliness. Others must brave the trials of leadership in family or other settings. And family leadership is the most common type of leadership and the most important type of leadership. And mind you, that's not exclusive to male patriarchal roles. Mothers, anyone who says mothers aren't great leaders is a fool, doesn't know much about mothers. And older siblings, too, and younger siblings, everyone. Okay, so the kingdom of God involves leadership for everyone, okay? Either of these has the ability to fully test us and prepare us for citizenship in the kingdom of God. While circumstances vary for everyone, the will of God includes the happy blessings of family life for all. Marriage and childbearing bring a divine joy which cannot be replaced by any other walk of life. Family settings are the foundation for experiencing all other things in life. This is why I'm a longtime advocate of not postponing as soon as you're old enough for a marriage, go for it. That's where you learn and grow. You expedite your learning and growing exponentially in family settings. Family settings where not just you're a dependent, but not where you're, but you know, just the receiver, but where you're in a giving role, as in a parent. Not just a parent, but a spouse, so forth. Though not all are blessed with families when they would like to have them, it is pleasing to God when we keep the doors open for family life, even to seek to walk there, to walk there through. Family life doesn't mean we can't have lofty careers, be writers, be public servants, or the myriad of other pleasing ways to serve others and God. Pleasing ways. I've heard prophets speak of a woman who feels called to be, a medical doctor. Go for it. It's not super strict and stuff. Of the limitations on what we can do, what we feel prompted to do, it plays a very big role in what we should do. Of course, we should take into mind all the commandments and counsels of God, and to remember that to obey is better than to sacrifice. That's one of the most important scriptures in the standard works, I think. To obey is better than to sacrifice. In other words, if you have a great idea, but that great idea of how to positively help the world, basically, it jeopardizes your ability to keep the commandments. Okay, I don't know if I included it in this text. I didn't, so let me just recount very briefly. Remember Elder Neil Anderson's talk on children, called Children. It was like 2013 or something. And he spoke of when President Kimball met with a young man who was in medical school, who the young man had read something about the importance of not procrastinating childbearing, and the young man went to the church public office and talked to President Kimball, and President Kimball said, "If you have faith, you can do both. You can have children and become a medical doctor." Okay, and President And Elder Anderson's idea in sharing this story was to present the idea that there's it's surprising what God can pull off when you include Him in your plans as the foundational compass. Family life will give more meaning and joy to us as we work in those roles. Family is the core of God's plan for His children. Everything else is auxiliary, meaning, and meant to uphold family life. Okay, the atonement of Jesus Christ is the center, as Joseph Smith said, to the God's plan. We couldn't progress to become eternal parents without the atonement. So yes, the atonement is the center. But why? The why of the atonement is families. Okay? The what is the atonement? The why is families. Everything in society is to maintain a scenario where families can be together. Family is the why of all the what. Thus, we see that neglecting family for the sake of something else is really quite ironic. To look further to the future, eventually all things fall away except for family relations. God is a man and his wife taking care of their children, whom we are. Ultimately, the ideal titles of the universe are husband, wife, and parent. Seek a personal relationship with God, perhaps like Tevye in Fiddler on the Roof, the old story about the trials and travels of the Jews, and the dealing with modern culture, where you make God a partner in your daily life, where you speak to Him in all your questions and so forth. Truly, our lives are changing rapidly, like they were in the times of Tevye, not only which is the early 19th century. Not only can you pray often like Tevye, you can read the scriptures often like him. His heart longs for more time to study the scriptures. He loves to familiarize himself with the character of God as seen in the scriptures. Someone has said that the devil trembles when he sees even the weakest of saints upon his knees. I think that was President Spencer W. Kimball in The Miracle of Forgiveness. Someone has said that the devil. Okay, there we go. President Thomas S. Monson was known to often pray. He prayed all the time. He was known for that. He needed to. Okay, none of us really have a clue what we're doing here, and we all need to talk to God all the time. The favorite hymn of President Spencer W. Kimball was, "I need thee every hour." Okay, the prophet needs him every hour. Okay. The prophets are. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, it talks about how the three presiding leaders of the Church of God are perfect men to emulate your lives after. Now, granted, no one is perfect except Jesus Christ, but the idea is that the apostles, that's a great thing to study. The living prophets, the presidents, apostles of the church of these latter days. It was said by one of our leaders that our apostles that studying the life of Joseph Smith is also one of the most important things you can do, because next to Jesus Christ, he's, personally, I think he's the seventh archangel, and I have some stuff to back that up, but that's for another day. None of us really have a clue what we're doing here. We all need to talk to God all the time. The favorite hymn of President Spencer W. Kimball is "I Need Thee Every Hour." Great men realize that they don't have a clue, and that they need God's help. Does the hour of prayer taste sweet to you? All right, that's all I've got for this. The God of individualized contracts.